Hello and welcome to this podcast edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. Last week, influential economist David Rosenberg, who presciently warned of the credit bubbles in housing and ensuing recession in 2006, told us we are now seeing the, quote, mother of all credit bubbles on steroids, because global debt levels have gone up 300% faster than the income to support it. And the indebtedness is happening at the household, business, and government levels. Rosenberg, who recently launched his own macro research and strategy firm, Rosenberg Research and Associates, has been predicting the U.S. is in imminent danger of falling into recession and that the debt albatross is a huge contributing factor. So tell me how bad it's going to be. I mean, I'm listening to you and I'm thinking, good grief, this could be, especially when I look at the debt levels and the level of interest rates, which are so low. So the servicing of all of that debt seems to be kind of manageable. It will be not manageable if interest rates go up. So tell me what you think, how bad the recession is going to be in the U.S. and the globe. Everybody's petrified of another financial crisis.
When you service the debt, you're going to pay the interest and the principal. It's interesting because even in Canada, Statistics Canada releases a ratio. I don't see this in the States. It's called the total financial obligation ratio in the household sector. And it's interesting that even with ultra-low interest rates in Canada, the household obligation ratio is actually higher today than it was when interest rates were double digits, 20 years ago. So it's not just nice to say, oh, well, interest rates are so low, it's manageable. You got to pay the principal of that mountain of debt.
Right, at least individuals do. Governments can, especially the U.S. government, can roll over, refinance. Right.
We have a situation in the United States where corporate debt is 50% of GDP. Started the cycle at 30%, never been this high. And then, of course, we also have 50% of the investment grade universe now rated triple B, potentially on the precipice of being downgraded to junk.
If we go into recession, if those companies aren't in better shape than they were.
It's just like Deep Throat told Woodward and Bernstein in the early 70s, follow the money. So you got to follow the bubble. Mm-hmm. We have an enormous bubble.
Debt bubble
on corporate balance sheets in the United States.
Now, let me just say one more thing, which you've heard before, but it was not an unintelligent move for corporations with interest rates this low to go out and issue these long-term bonds and at historically low interest rates. That was not necessarily such a dumb idea. Right? Wasn't that actually prudent in many cases? I'm not talking about governments. I'm talking now about corporations.
Well, you see, but the story doesn't end there.
So why does that have to end badly?
There's another chapter to the story. Well, I didn't say that it was necessarily going to end badly. I just said that I don't believe that it's different this time. Mm-hmm. You'll never, and I don't believe that the business cycle is dead. I know that there's probably other people that actually believe that.
Right. So the indebtedness is going to come back and haunt them.
Well, it's
sooner.
Always, We have an incredible, here's what I'm saying. We have an incredible debt bubble. That's why interest rates can't go up. But what I was saying before, when you're talking about this wonderful longevity of a 10-year cycle, it was perpetuated by a dramatic increase in debt. Even so, you asked me about what extended the cycle. Well, you know what? I'm not going to say that the Trump and the congressional tax plan had no impact on GDP. I just said it didn't have an enduring impact
right.
on GDP. But if we're going to go through recurring rounds of deficit-financed tax cuts and spending, I mean, you'll give the allure of there being organic growth when it's all just being facilitated by incremental debt at a time when the debt ratio has never been as high as it is. So it's just an unstable equilibrium. I mean, we have not had a cycle of productivity. Here's the situation as I see it. And I could throw the question back to you. Yes, companies borrowed incredible amounts of money at low interest rates. What did they do with the money? Now, if you're going to say to me, oh, well, look at the data on capital spending. What an business investment cycle this was. And I'd say, hey, you know what? Business borrowed the money. They invested in the real economy. They're going to earn a perpetual after-tax rate of return on the money invested vis-a-vis the cost of capital. And by the way, the capital deepening is going to produce productivity growth, and that's critical for the income that the country needs to service the debt. Well, what a powerful story. You'd actually start calling me the permabull. But this was the biggest debt for equity swap of all time. What do companies do with the money that they
stock
borrowed?
Buybacks.
Stock buybacks. And actually,
dividend payouts.
It's perfect perfect symmetry, $4 trillion of quantitative easing. And what happened is the Fed hoovered all those safe securities, mostly treasuries, open up a vacuum for the corporate sector. Don't need the banks. Well, the banks are capital constrained anyways and regulated, went to the public markets, and the public markets wanted, investors wanted this stretch for yield. Who cares about covenants? Who cares about default risk? I just want the yield in a yield-starved world.
Mm-hmm.
And so corporations flooded it and then bought back their stock, which then gives this allure of this wonderful earnings cycle. But
wealth.
You see, it's earnings per share because you're taking the share count down. Not dollar billions of earnings, earnings per share take the share count down because CEOs get paid for EPS,
yes,
earnings per share. So you inflate and you give this illusion of there being some sort of wonderful earnings recovery that's not really quite there. It's a share buyback story. So that's really what happened. We didn't have capital deepening. This went down as the weakest capital spending cycle of all time. In fact, the weakest economic growth cycle of all time. And you'll say, yeah, well, that actually will help extend because there was no big economic bubble. And I'm saying, yes, there was no economic bubble. What I'm saying is that there's a huge financial bubble. When you say to me, well, all that debt, they raised at lower interest rates, they still have to service that debt notwithstanding. The question is, what happens when the recession comes?
Right.
And this is what happens. This is a game of cat and mouse. And here's what I want to say. I want to say that the bubble bursting does not cause the recession, okay? The recession causes the bubble to burst, okay? I went back at the very beginning of our interview to the late 80s. It was the recession that followed the Fed tightening cycle that caused the commercial construction and the SNLs to burst, not the other way around. It was the recession that caused the impairment of the dot-coms. And then in the last cycle, the recession actually started in December of 07. That's when the economic expansion officially ended. Well, if memory serves me correctly, Bear Stearns went down 3 months later.
Right.
If I'm not mistaken, Lehman and AIG and Merrill went down 6 months later. All the stuff happened because what does a recession do? A recession impairs cash flow. And then the impairment of the cash flow impairs the ability to service the debt. And that's when you get delinquencies, defaults, and downgrades.
Has the recession started yet, as far as you're concerned, or when do you think it's going to start? Again, it's kind of been delayed.
Right.
Thought it would.
Yeah, I thought it would have started by now, and I think that the consumer certainly hung in more than I thought. I just think that the lags are taking longer. But you know, Consuelo, remember I was early on the last call. You know, it's funny. I was viewed as being crazy early, and actually, I also caught the dot-coms. I was crazy early both times. But then, as the storm hits, people don't forget that you were early. They just remember that you were right.
Right, and I know you have been predicting kind of throughout this recovery a couple of times that we'd have a double dip recession at one point, right? So there have been times when you've seen a recession looming when it hasn't materialized. And what have you learned from those calls? And what's different now that you think, okay, this is for real. Now it's really going to happen. And as I said earlier, I mean, how bad is the recession going to be? From what you're describing, it sounds scary to me.
The economy was on such shaky ground in 2010, 2011, 2012, that the Fed had to embark on massive rounds of quantitative easing.
Right.
Massive. And so I think that what helped extend the cycle were these repeated periods where the Fed was injecting the system with liquidity, and it didn't create booming economic conditions, but it certainly helped prevent the double dip from happening.
Is that possible now? Does the Fed have any power left to, or is it have much less leverage now?
I think, like I said, this is the one area where I think Donald Trump was right. I think the Fed over-tightened.
Yep.
Now, don't forget, in those periods in 2010, 2011, 2012, I was looking at a very fragile economy, and the economy was very fragile, and the Fed became very aggressive. You know, Ben Bernanke, he didn't raise rates, right?
His last rate hike,
I think, was the summer of 2006.
How bad, you know, compare what you're expecting to other periods in history?
One thing I'll say is that it's not going to be as bad as the last recession. Okay.
Okay, so that's a relief.
People get relief out of that. But people don't know that, and I think this is right, that the 1973 to 75 recession was actually worse post-revisions than the last one, which we call the Great Recession. Because I guess the Great Recession, involved a financial collapse.
73, 74 was a horrible period.
Yeah.
And we had, for the economy.
1980, and the double dip recessions of 80 to 82. I think the problem is going to be less about the magnitude of the decline in the economy, mm-hmm. more about how do we get out of it? How do we get out of the next recession?
And
I think we're going to go back down to zero on the Fed funds rate. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
I think the Fed could be on pause for now, but I don't think they'll be on pause indefinitely. The yield curve will steepen, but it will melt. Rates are going to go down a lot more. Mm-hmm. They're going to engage.
And steepen means that the long-term rates will, the difference between short and long-term rates will be steeper.
Well, what it means is that as they go down to zero, the 10-year note might go down to 1%. Mm-hmm. So the yield curve will steepen, but in a bond bull market.
Mm-hmm.
But bringing down interest rates will help out the housing market, help out interest-sensitive spending at the margin. A steeper yield curve will help out the financials. There'll be a lot of benefits from that. The Fed's not ready to do it yet because the Fed, historically, as it is today, a very incremental institution. They are responsive. They're not proactive.
Right.
And I think that they will do more quantitative easing, which they're doing through the back door right now in the treasury bill market. They'll do a lot more quantitative easing. But I think ultimately what we have to do is understand what has been the largest constraint on economic growth globally and in the United States. It's not about aging demographics, which really has its impact glacially. And it's not about the rapid ascension and advance of technology and the technological change that creates uncertainty. It's really about the mountain of debt. The mountain of debt is a massive constraint on aggregate demand growth globally. Okay, and I come back to what you said before about, 10 years of recovery and things don't seem. Why is it that the Fed got stopped out at 2.5%? That hasn't happened since the 1930s. Why could the Fed? The Fed always told us we want to normalize interest rates. Well, if you asked a rational person, did the Fed actually normalize interest rates this cycle? Because how do you normalize interest rates mm-hmm. in an abnormal environment? So interest rates in the world's, people call the United States the cleanest shirt in the laundry basket. Here's the cleanest shirt in the laundry basket. Here's the only central bank that had the temerity to actually try and normalize interest rates, mm-hmm. and they couldn't even do it.
Where do you think interest rates should be?
Well, what I'm saying is that a few years ago, you asked some of the brightest lights in the business, they would tell you a normal rate would be at least 3%,
right.
Or maybe 4.
Now we're talking much lower levels.
We're talking much lower levels, and that's a whole dissertation on why that's the case. Okay. The point I'm making is that the Fed, so I'm trying to say, I call this the Potemkin economic expansion. Potemkin, Grigor Potemkin mm-hmm. was the general that built fake cities.
Yes.
We built this on a mountain of debt. Okay, this is a house of straw. And I know that people actually, they don't see it or they don't want to see it. But that was what perpetuated is that more debt, more QE, more debt, and more life support for this expansion. Okay, and then Jay Powell comes in and says, I didn't hear actually Ben Bernanke, when he dared to say, I think back in 2013, that he was going to start to pull the plug away, the markets went like ape.
Yes.
And then, Janet Yellen was sort of like, a placeholder, I guess, in between. And the first thing that Jay Powell talked about actually at his confirmation hearing in January of 2018 was he says, we have to normalize interest rates. Now, I think in his mind, he was thinking, we're going to go 3+ on the funds rate. Well, what's interesting is that they couldn't even get it above 2.5%. Mm-hmm. People have to ask themselves the question, how is it, if it's such a wonderful economy, a reflationary economy, a 10-year economic expansion with unemployment at 3.5%, that the peak in the funds rate was 2.5%? Seriously, what is that telling you?
What is it telling you?
That things are fundamentally weak, that we can't raise the rates because we can't service it otherwise. And it's, how come the ECB never raised rates? They never tightened policy. Mario Draghi's last act was to do more QE. Why did Mark Carney at the Bank of England, they went to 0.5?
So they saw the weakness and admitted it and went there, right?
I would say that the I said before that the stock market relationship with the economy is all but broken down.
Okay.
But so not true, but not true with interest rates, okay? Interest rates, you're telling you, interest rates, what is more powerful? I mean, Albert Einstein actually famously said that the power of compound interest is the eighth wonder of the world. Mm-hmm. Interest rates are telling you something about the economy, okay? Then here's what it's telling you about the economy. It might not be telling you about a recession, but it's telling you that the underpinnings for this economic backdrop are very poor.
And stock market. Let's just switch to the stock market. The stock market has been, you know, doing well. You mentioned earlier that it's a very narrow cohort that's been doing extremely well. We're still in a, you know, bull market of sorts as far as the major indexes are concerned, the Dow and the S&P. What's your read on the stock market and how vulnerable the stock market is?
I have to say that, you know, it's just a good thing that I was bullish on treasuries, so that at least there was an asset class where I helped people make money.
And they have done incredibly well.
But that's no excuse for the fact that I've missed the stock market rally. It's caught me by surprise.
Mm-hmm. For years, you have been advising your clients to invest in the kind of the dividend aristocrats.
Yeah.
That's actually been a very good recommendation, right?
Right.
If you're looking at a total return basis, compounding,
that
was a good place to be.
Well, I like bonds. And I said to people that if you want to have toes in the equity risk pool, then own the bonds and drag is what I call them.
Mm-hmm.
So whether it was utilities, whether it was the REITs or the staples or even healthcare, I mean, there was 100% right. Thank you for that.
Mm-hmm.
I have been actually beating myself up somewhat for the missed overall equity market call, but the dividend story has been an alluring and enduring one.
That's
for
been
me.
A good
but
one. Mm-hmm.
But the point is that I didn't think that the we'd be seeing 3,100 on the S&P or 28,000 on the Dow. So, you know, when you miss a call, you have to be responsible and think about, you know, what's going on and try and explain it.
Well, and also, what now?
But I'm saying, well, I don't
know.
But here's the reality: I don't really have an explanation.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know where are these flows coming from. We have this unusual, bizarre situation. It's like cognitive dissonance, where companies are buying back their stock, but the insiders are selling the stock.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a month ago in the Bank of America Merrill Lynch survey, my alma mater, cash holdings among global portfolio managers are at their highest level since 2009. And then within a month, that cash has gone into the market and the growth expectations have swung higher to an extent we have not seen apparently since 1994. And I'm there thinking like, what happened in the past month? What, that there is enthusiasm over phase one, which even if we get phase one, it's just all the easy stuff, which they still can't seem to get done. And I couldn't understand, how do you connect the dots from a deal that really just involves Chinese buying of soybeans from Midwest farmers to a 3-point multiple expansion of the S&P 500? I don't know. I can't really explain it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you right now, if I can't explain something to investors, I will tell them. And personally, I've been on the sidelines. When I can't explain something, when it doesn't make sense to me, I'll tell you what I do.
Mm-hmm.
I avoid it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I can understand things that I've missed in the past, and I will do my retribution, and I will do my analysis, and I'll figure out I'm not going to make that mistake again. But this just looks like a little too much like Grigor Potemkin to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm on the sidelines right now.
So let's talk about some of the sectors that have performed well historically in recessions. And that's, you know, something that you've been talking to clients about. And certainly U.S. Treasuries perform well.
Yeah.
And investment grade bonds. Would you still go there? I mean, is that still a place that's going to give you protection and give you actually positive returns in a recession?
Well, you know, it's interesting because last year at this time, you know, when say the long bond was around 3.5%, all I heard from people was, What idiot would buy a long bond and lock it in at 3.5%? Well, you know, nobody's, unless you're an insurance company or you have to basically do asset liability matching, nobody's really buying these for 30 years any more than the average duration of the S&P 500 is 50 years, okay? I don't see people buying stocks and holding them on to 50 years. So, but it's funny because I find that the equity market people, they don't know bond market math. But the bond market people, they know equity market math. So here's the reality. The moron that bought the long bond at 3.5% a year ago is the same moron that generated a 31% total return.
Right.
Because of the power of convexity, the relationship between prices and yields, especially at these low level of interest rates, is very powerful. So despite all the euphoria over the stock market, the reality is that the best performing asset in the past year has been the 30-year treasury. I'm not going to say here that we're going to get another 31% return going forward, but I do think that there's two things the treasury market, maybe three things it'll give you. It'll give you liquidity in the portfolio. It will give you some recurring income. Might not be a big income, but it'll be a source of support for the portfolio. Mm-hmm. And especially if things go wrong, it's a great insurance policy. Look, if I'm right that the economy is going to weaken further, that as a result, inflationary pressures are going to continue to subside, then yields are going to go down. The question is by how much. So I think that the total return in the treasury market, especially the long end, is going to be pretty good. Mm-hmm. If you're going to ask me, would I even at these, you know, you'd say even at these low level of yields, now that the long bond's down to say 2.25, why would you want to do that? Well, because I think the long bond is going to go probably down to 1.5%. So you will basically get a very decent total return out of that. But nobody seems to say, boy, would you want to buy equities with a 17.5 forward multiple?
Right.
And so, you know, you could argue that everything is expensive. Everything is expensive. Maybe volatility isn't expensive. That's pretty cheap and another way to protect your portfolio. But I would say that my belief is that as low as yields are, we haven't hit bottom yet. I mean, mm-hmm. right now we are at the peak of the cycle, the lows in unemployment, peak of the stock market. And the long bond yield is 2.25. The 10-year is 180. And
if it's a recession, they're going to go lower.
Well, and take a look where they are around the world. If anything, the U.S. is the cleanest shirt in the laundry basket when it comes to interest rate, relative interest rates. You know,
the U.S. Treasury.
We're the smartest kid in summer school.
Right. I mentioned earlier the dividend aristocrats, the kind of high quality companies with a history of paying dividends. That is another asset class that has performed relatively well in recessions. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, dividends.
So if you want to be in equities, that is a one place to be.
I would say that you want to screen for a few things. You want to screen for you want to screen for companies with low payout ratios that have a history of paying their dividends. Companies that have never cut their dividends, even in tough times, that have a yield better than what you get in the treasury market. Okay, well these days that's not that difficult. But also in non-cyclical areas of the marketplace, areas that have low correlations with GDP. Mm-hmm. And yeah, you can actually construct an equity portfolio even in a recession and do just fine. But
gold.
It's very selective. And you want to cull the portfolio. You really want to get down to best ideas, a small group of stocks. This is not really a time for being diversified. You really want to focus on high quality, strong balance sheets, dividend characteristics,
non-cyclical.
Look, there's one bellwether company in the S&P whose sales actually went up in 08 and 09 and whose stock made you money. You know who it was?
Mm-mm.
Walmart. And that still might well be the case. It's all part of the in a recession, you want to focus on frugality. And you want to focus on what consumers do. And spending doesn't go to zero. It never goes to zero. But people trade down. And the trade down market tends to grab market share, and they do okay.
That leads me actually to the final question that we always ask everyone in an interview on WealthTrack. And that's, if you had one investment that you would have us make in a long-term diversified portfolio, especially given that you think we're going to go into a recession, what would it be?
Well, I would say to stick with what works. And I would still say that even with these low yields, I would be concentrating my attention on the long bond.
30-year.
The 30-year treasury bond. The 30-year treasury bond, well, if I'm right, it's always the assumption.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm right on my macro call, you will make a significant total return. And just think about what happened in this past year. Think of the total return in the long treasury, over 30%. And the recession hasn't even started yet. And there's never been a cycle where bond yields go up or the total return goes down in a recession. It's going to be positive, in my opinion. The question is, how positive will the returns be in the bond market? At these levels of multiples in the stock market writ large for the major averages, and looking at where I see earnings coming in, I think when you're taking a look at risk return and looking at probabilities, because in this business, look, there's no such thing as a sure thing.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say that looking at the relative probabilities and, of course, the asset classes, how they perform in an economic downturn, bonds are going to outperform stocks.
I want to thank David Rosenberg for being our guest for this two-part WealthTrack podcast. If you missed the first installment, you can find it on WealthTrack.com. You can also hear him discuss why he decided to go out on his own, chasing his dream, his vision for his new firm. Thank you so much for spending time with us. Make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.